The following message by Pastor Dennis Clark and Dr. Jennifer Clark is brought to you by Full Stature Ministries and its supporters. For more information about Full Stature Ministries, please visit forgive123.com. That's forgive123.com.
Have officially opened our Team Embassy online school. What's more, we have some students who have signed up. Now, the Training Embassy for Advanced Ministries, this is where you go in. You can go to the Forgive123 website, and there's a button that will take you to the Team Embassy online school, and there is a drop down on Forgive123 under training that says online school. You go to the teamembassy.com website. There's also a drop down and a button where you can click that will take you into the courses.
It's you click on the lady who's sitting at the computer right above that.
Team Embassy Online School, we're starting out with low introductory rates. We will be adding more features and courses later, and prices will go up, but you can lock in low introductory rates now. And it's actually got so much in some of the courses that our Pastor Molly said, you're giving them too much. Just today, this morning, I got a text from Pastor Jason that Module 1, Team Light Module 1, has just gone up. This is the one that so many people come here to take. In the future, we're going to offer video sessions with Pastor Dennis, webinars, video sessions. Also, for the courses, those who complete the requirements for the courses will be given hand-signed certificates of completion mailed to them. Now, some of the courses that are currently offered now are the 60-day challenge. And this has a lot of features, including daily videos, downloadable manual, and lots of other features. They did that at 15-minute intervals. Whenever it ended one demonstration, they would stop it and practice it. And people have always also used this in home groups to work with groups of people. And you know what? That's what we've heard from people all over the world. I always heard from the pulpit what I was supposed to do, but I never knew how to do it until now. So we get thank you testimonies for that. Also, the Secrets Revealed Archive. You can sign up, and the videos that were taped in our studio for Sid Ross ISN, It's Supernatural Network show, a large selection has been archived, and you can pay a fee and watch all you want of those shows, and you cannot watch the archived shows anywhere else. Also, as I said, I started off with this, the Team Light Module 1 is just up as of this morning, and Pastor Jason is working even now on Modules 2, 3, and 4. And eventually, we will also have the module on how to minister to sexual issues. But we will be taping that in our studio. We have the audio for that, but we'll be taping that in our studio, particularly for the online school. And that, too, will come with a very large downloadable manual. So I hope you'll go on training.teamembassy.com. And you can check out the school, or click on the lady sitting at the computer on forgive123.com, and it will take you right here. And you can look around all you want. You can see some video introductions and what is included in the different courses. So I hope you'll check it out. We are very excited about this. We have wanted this for so long because it's time for the body of Christ worldwide to be equipped with the how-tos. Amen.
Spending time Looking at Jason and Gwen's testimony and everything, the Lord reminded me of things in our testimony, how we overcome by the blood of the Lamb, by the word of our testimony. We love not our lives unto death. That the word of your testimony is not information. It's not secondhand information. If it's the word of your testimony, it's probably some of the greatest reality of your Christian walk, because it's where you were transformed, and that you were transformed significantly enough to where you have a changed life. And what the Lord spoke to me was basically that people are right now need to get back what you think you have lost. You did not lose it. God can always, through a genuine repentance for any mistakes on your part, but the disqualified by others and those who have disqualified themselves can, through legitimate repentance, get back on track. And it's interesting that God's got a supernatural story for absolutely every believer. And it's just a question if you want the God story or you want your own story. God prepared beforehand for works, and you can do your own thing, or you can literally yield to what God wanted you to do. The good thing is that even when you get off track, he can get you back on track. And he used that story, going through some of my old notes, I came across something that just leaped off the page. So believe it or not, I want this for my grandchildren and my spiritual children, my natural children and my spiritual children, so that there's a record of it on CD. I think somewhere there's a record of it on cassette, but most of you wouldn't do you any good if I handed you a cassette. You don't have anything to play it on anymore. It's like an 8-track. It's kind of obsolete now, right? Prehistoric. But anyway, I'm calling this message the beginning, because in looking through my old journals, and I've always kept the journals from all 40 years that I've been a believer, if not more, and I love going back and looking at some of the things, and this would be even before my son Jason was born, so I'm going to start right there. My birthday's coming up this Tuesday on the 22nd, the Day of Atonement, good for me, all right? It's a good time to repent, because repentance gets you back on track. And I was looking at some of the old journal notes I had. September 22nd, which is my birthday, 1973. Wow. I know a lot of you weren't born yet. So that makes it even more exciting, because then I can just about cover this. And I guess that's 42 years ago, huh? Something like that. Wow. Man, I had brown hair then. September 22nd, 1973, had a mobile home, was partying, getting high, and it was celebrating. That's the way we celebrated in those days. Smoking dope, getting high, and it was a mobile home that I had, and the bathroom had a sliding door, you know, sliding door instead of a door that opens up. It just slid. One of the girls got high, had a panic attack because she was trying to open the door like a regular door. And other high people, in their attempt to help, literally took the door off the track instead of sliding it. All right? Those were the good days, huh? These were the days when you got high and had parties and did all kinds of sensible things. And what really gripped me was in my prayer time, God said, he pointed me to that off the track. And he's basically saying that now there's a trumpet call, there's a prophetic call to many people who have disqualified themselves, others have disqualified you, but God's going to get you back on track. And as long ago as that was, I'm just saying this is a time to get back on track, because you can be deceived, you can be pulled in all different directions, you can think what you're doing is really cool, what's really right, and be dead wrong, right? I was convinced I was just doing what I wanted to do. Nobody's going to tell me what to do. I'm going to have fun. And that's the beginning. That beginning showed you where doing it your own way can get you, no matter how smart you think you are. I was born and raised in South Chicago,
moved to Pennsylvania as a teenager. But prior to that, my next door neighbor was a gang leader, 19 years old, I was 15. And his wife wanted him to settle down now that he was married. And why don't you just spend time with Dennis next door and go do sensible things instead of getting in gang fights? Why don't you go fishing and stuff like that? I can remember a time he took me fishing, and he's driving along in the car, me and him, and he's just talking, and somebody was cutting him off the road two times. He pulled in front of him, got out of his car, pulled the guy out, beat him up, put him back in his car, got back in the car and kept talking to me like nothing happened. Oh my God. And I'm going. But he was a fantastic pool player, and I met most of my friends were behind a cue stick. And he had shot exhibition matches with famous people like Willie Moscone and other pool champions. And he was what they would call a hustler. He basically made his living shooting pool and taught a lot of bad stuff that way. Matter of fact, I almost got beat up if it wasn't for a couple of big friends that I had, because I saw that I could make money the same way he's making money. So I normally shoot pool left-handed, and he taught me everything. Really, really a lot, because that was part of his settling down and not being in a gang no more. Called the gang was called the Athiptos, the Unconquerable, all right? And he was settling down, and just he was just going to hustle pool and go fishing with me and be nice to this 15-year-old that lived next door to him, because he was married now. He had to act sensible. He was 19 and married, and he had to be calm down. Although his wife was in a girl gang in her day, and I can remember one time in a Dairy Queen parking lot, she beat some girl up, rubbed her face in the gravel, and pulled her pierced earrings out of her ear. So she was not a pussycat either, but she wanted to settle down, all right? So these were my friends behind the cue stick. These are the people that I met, most of my friends, including my neighbor. And then eventually, got transferred as a teenager to Chicago, Illinois. I mean, from Chicago, Illinois to Pennsylvania. My dad got transferred. Very interesting that the one city I made fun of was a friend of mine. If you can think of the multitudes of people in Chicago, I mean, there are millions and millions and millions. I don't know what the population is now, but it was huge then. And out of that entire population, what were the chances? But I'm making fun of my buddy who's moving out of Chicago. And he's moving to a little city, and it had a funny name. And so I made fun of it. I don't know, people are going to be watching, so I'm going to choose my words carefully here. But I made fun of this city. I said, but the name of this high school is High. And it was like, and then I go home, and my dad works for the same, he's an engineer, and he worked for the same company. He says, by the way, I have a choice for a promotion, but if I don't transfer, I don't get the promotion, and we're going to, and I go, oh, no. What were the chances that my buddy's dad and my dad worked at the same place and they're both getting transferred? I mean, it was like one in a million. So the Lord has a sense of humor. I'm going to jump ahead. Many, 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 many years later, when I planted a church, I looked around all the surrounding communities, could not find a place to get property, except in that city there was property, 12 acres of land, two-story building, built a dome sanctuary and everything. But it's at the very city I made fun of was where God had me later, after I got saved, plant the church. These are the beginnings. I was smoking dope and making fun of a TV preacher, and I was laughing at him, called him Smiley, because he was always smiling. Does this ring a bell with anybody? There's only so many TV preachers, but I was making fun of him, and all of a sudden, it cut right through the dope, right through the atmosphere. He said, there's someone out there that needs this message right now. And that finger went right through the TV, was pointing at me, and I was stoned, from stoned to stone sober, instantly. All of a sudden, it was, I needed that. That guy that I was making fun of. Goes to show you, be careful what you laugh about, all right? Because it might be the very thing that gets you. If I laughed about a city, that was where I planted my first church. When I laughed about a TV preacher, that's where I got saved. So be careful when you mock. God gets the last laugh, you know. Isaac, you don't want to be an Isaac. to where you're just the laughter. But anyway, I got born again, and I was looking at my notes. I thought it was about 6 months, but looking at my old journals and stuff, it was 4 months. I was saved 4 months from that TV preacher, and I didn't feel anything other than a mild inner knowing that this is the way you are called to live. Nothing real supernatural except the fact that I got instantly sober, walked over to the drain, and was pouring my marijuana down the garbage disposal. All the while, my head's going, you could have at least sold it if you're not going to smoke it. You could have sold it. You could have made some money on it. And, you know, thoughts work like that even when you're obeying God. Isn't it interesting? There's always a dialogue of, so I poured it down the drain, and for 4 months, I was convinced I only had one inner statement, was this makes sense. This was the way we were meant to live. Finally, this was right. No feelings, no supernatural, nothing. And for 4 months, it was just, this is the way we're supposed to live. But I definitely was not very overt. I didn't witness to nobody. As a matter of fact, I did indirect witnessing. Like, you know, so-and-so is one of those Christians. Interesting how they look like they got it together. I would use other people instead of my life. I would use other people. See, look at they look, they're living better. That's the way we were meant to live, you know. And so for 4 months, nothing extraordinary. And then I heard about a church in Ohio that was 25 miles away, and Catholics and Protestants were coming together, and they were having worship services. And I thought it was interesting with my Catholic background that Catholics and Protestants were going to the same place. And it was a very popular church in that day. They had all the big name charismatic speakers from the 60s and 70s. And we went, and I knew I was saved, and I'm standing, and it was a church that had the pews, and I'm standing in the pew, and my first supernatural thing started happening. I went like this. I'm going, this thing wants me to go up. They had a call for baptism in the Holy Spirit. I didn't know what that was. I go, I'm saved. I ain't going up. And I'm going, but why is my body going up? I'm not going up. And I'm going, this is really weird. I think might as well just go up. So I went up, and they said, blah, 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 blah. I don't know what they said. And I went back and went, that was interesting. All I know is that I was going up when I wasn't going to go up, and I was holding on, and it didn't matter. My body was trying to go. So I went, that was weird. So I thought nothing of it. I went home, and I decided that it was time that I leveled with people after 4 months and tell them, I'm a Christian. You know, I got to get a little bit more bold with this thing. I saw people raising their hands, and I'm going, oh, I ain't doing that. You know, lifting their hands up, I'm going, I'm not doing that. But they certainly didn't have any fear. And so I'm going, you know what? I'm kind of a chicken, then. That makes me look kind of bad. You know what I'm going to do? I'm going to go to my mom and dad's house. I'm going to march in there, and I'm going to tell them, I'm a Christian. And so I went. I marched into the house full of mixed emotion, and then I walked in, and nobody was home. And so I go, whew. Well, oh, by the way, I got to tell you one part. When I left that altar, this is some of the stuff I should leave out, but when I left that altar, there was a guy in there who went, hi, Dennis. I knew I'd see you here someday. This is 25 miles from where I live. He was the guy that when I managed a shoe store, I used to physically throw him out of my store. I was really bad, physically threw him out, because he used to tell me about Jesus all the time. I'm going, getting this Jesus guy out of my store. And then when you leave the altar, hi, Dennis. Remember me, I'm the guy you throw out of your store physically. Yeah, okay. Just thought I'd throw that in there. Why is God like this with me? He must know Dennis the Menace needed this. I mean, I needed this. I mean, that the shoe store guy was an orthopedic shoe store that was across from me in the mall. He was from Chicago originally too, and he liked me, and he wanted to teach me orthopedics. He wanted me to have a future in the shoe business and whatever. And then he'd watch me, and I had a complaining customer. I took him outside and beat him up in a parking lot. He goes, "That is not the way a manager behaves. That I can't teach you anything as long as you're doing that kind of stuff." Well, he came in, he took a shoe off the display and said, "I bet these shanks in these shoes are weak." And he went and broke it. And I said, "Well, we should settle this adjustment. Let's go outside in the parking lot and we will settle this." He said, "That's not the way you run a business." Okay. But anyway, I'm telling you, I'm giving you the beginning. This is for my grandchildren to someday go, "Oh, Grandpa was." All right. But the only book, because I was talking indirectly Christian stuff, my dad wasn't a Christian, but there was a guy who gave him a book at work. He was about a gambler who was on the 700 Club, and he was delivered from gambling, which, as Jennifer knows, that's one of the most difficult addictions to get rid of because it has intermittent reinforcement. Intermittent reinforcement says you can lose a million times in a row and it won't faze you because you're still waiting for that one big one. And that's a hard addiction to get rid of. But anyway, he was on the 700 Club, and he wrote a book, and my dad brought that book home. Now, apart from the Living Bible, in 4 months, that was the only Christian book I ever read. So even though I decided to express it to my parents that I'm a Christian, they weren't home. And so I glanced down. This is right after going to that church 25 miles away and getting prayed. I glanced down and there was a Bible. Managed to get Living Bibles into the family anyway. Nobody was saved then, but I got Bibles into their house. So that probably was kind of a witness. Here's a Bible, you know. But I looked and I glanced down and there was a Bible there. So I sat down and I just said, basically, "God," again, the same theme, I saw shyness or timidity, which was a real, in the city, that was a real badge of sissy. And so I said, "This Christian thing, if I'm going to do this, I'm going to do it right. And I'm shy and I'm backward about it. And I don't like that. This is the way we were meant to live. And therefore," and it's the street talk. Now, this is a dumb way to pray, so don't pray like this. But I said, "God, I'm really scared to say this, but I'm trying to make a point, God. Even if I was in a wheelchair and could never walk again, I'm going to live for you and serve you all the days of my life. But I'm not asking for that. I'm just saying I'm trying to talk street talk to God to tell him that I mean business." And I did. I meant business from my heart. And I meant, no matter what happens, I'm going to live for you and serve you all the days of my life, because this is the way people were meant to live, but not with my timidity. And the minute I said that, I was flooded with a presence. This is where they threw me on TV and radio, even as a baby Christian when I didn't know what I was talking about. But the experience was so powerful. I got flooded with the presence of joy that was so strong, I thought my skin was going to explode. And my first thought was, we would have to have a new body in heaven because this body couldn't handle anything more than what I was experiencing. And if that wasn't enough, because no one ever told me there was feelings, my Christianity up until that point, I didn't feel nothing except an inner assurance that this is the way we're supposed to live. And all of a sudden, I'm flooded. I'm praying in the spirit, and that scared me. And then I'm flooded with joy, and that scared me. And then I had in my mind's eye, saw Jesus in me, filling me from head to toe by the power of the Spirit, worshiping the Father. And the Father, too, was in me, and it was Father, Son, Holy Spirit, and it was easily understandable. And all of a sudden, it was like I was starting to feel the joy, but also thinking, maybe I'm losing my mind or I'm going to die. And if I am, I want to stay this way. I didn't care. So I'm going, if I'm dying, I sure am happy. And if I'm not dying and I'm cracking, I'm having a mental breakdown, then I want to stay with a mental breakdown because I've never felt this. No drug ever made me feel like this. So I'm going, if I'm crazy, so be it. Stay there. And I'm going, And then it was got even worse. Then, with my, there's difference in when you say vision. There's people get visions in their mind's eye, and then there's visions that with your eyes wide open. This is what an open vision. My eyes were wide open, and there was letters of living light that I can see as clearly today as it was when it happened. And it spelled out Grand Book and Bible. That was a Christian bookstore. I'd never been there, but I knew where it was. It was in a little plaza. Grand Book and Bible, but the letters were living light, and I read it with my mind, and I read it in here. Didn't know how to explain it, but I like absorbed the words. And I was in a state of shock that I don't know what's going on. I've never seen anything like this. And why would you see in with your eyes wide open in the air living letters? And they were living letters. It was living light letters that said Grand Book and Bible, and I'm reading it with my entire being. And I didn't know what to do. So I looked down at that Bible. It got worse. I looked down at that Bible and I opened, and I think, this has been so long ago, I think it opened to the first chapter of Isaiah. I could be mistaken. But I opened the Bible and then the page went totally blank except for one word. Obey. Well, that took that all that euphoria and everything, and at least gave me something to do. Because I was really beside myself that no one, I never heard of anybody talk like this. I never had anybody say anything happens like this. And all I know is that infusion of his presence was so strong and so powerful that I thought my body was going to explode. Then I have to get a vision. Then I'm going, obey. So I get in the car and I'm driving, crying, going to the Grand Book and Bible bookstore. It's only about a mile and a half away. And I'm driving and I'm going, and the devil was right there too saying, you're crazy, you cracked up, you lost your mind. And I'm going, well, so? I don't care, I'm gonna stay like this, I love it. But then I'm going, well, maybe I did. Well, if I tell anybody, then for sure they will put me away. I cannot tell this to anybody. And I get to Grand Book and Bible, and then I realize, I walk in the door, and then I realize, I don't have any more information than that. What do I do now? I'm in this bookstore. So in a daze, I walk over and I'm going like this through pamphlets and books and totally not reading anything, because that's where my instruction ended. Grand Book and Bible, obey. I'm there. Next thing you know, this woman comes out of the back room, a clerk, and she grabs me by the elbow and goes, young man, are you in? Do you have questions or something like that? She said, and I went, and I didn't get an answer. She goes, I've got a man for you to meet. Today is your lucky day. And she took me over, and here's that guy that was on the 700 Club with the gambling book, autographed, doing a book signing. And she went over there, and I'm going, maybe he'd understand. I wanted to tell my mom and dad I don't be Christian, and I don't want to have any. And then there's something, oh, that is, and then this light came out, and then this letter said Grand Book of Bible. And then I blew him right out of the water. He had no idea what this hysterical person was saying. And so he said, I think you ought to go to the Christian businessman's luncheon. I went, okay, go to a Christian businessman's luncheon. I went, okay. And so I went home, and I'm still with this joy. It was so strong. I was walking in presence of some unsaved relatives, and they start crying, and I never said nothing. Didn't even say a word. Tears just started to pour from their eyes. And I'm walking, and I'm going, I know they can feel this. Everybody's got to feel this. But how come? Then my head got in the way. It's like, but I was like the scum of the earth. This should happen. You hear my Catholic in this. This should happen to popes and bishops and cardinals, not me. Why me? This should happen to authority big shots. Why me? If this, why? And don't know if I ever got an answer to that. And glance, and all of a sudden, I'm going crazy. I know what I'm going to do. We get religious fast. I did the same things over and over. I'm going to go to my parents' house and tell them. That's the scene of the crime. I'm returning to the scene of the crime. So I got to tell somebody this. And then I went to my parents' house, and I walk in the door, and they weren't home again. Sit down, look at the open Bible. I go, oh, I remember what happened the last time I did that. Oh, geez, my heart's pounding and everything. And while I'm there, I glance down at a magazine rack that my mom had by the fireplace, and it was Psychology Today magazine, and it, on the cover, it had the UFO children. I picked it up, and it said, UFO children, the brilliant and well-educated people are going out to the Arizona desert to get on a spaceship to go to the Father's kingdom. And in here, I felt like throwing up. And I'm going, all of a sudden, I saw how confused that even intelligent people can be, how deceived that intelligence is not the answer, that they could be just as deceived as anyone else. And I put it down, and then I went and I said, God, why? Now what's so obvious to me is, why doesn't everybody understand this? This is so clear that this is the way we are meant to live. Why? And I saw in my mind's eye, like when I was a kid, I had this little football game. It was an electric board, and you put the little football players on the board, you turn the power on, the board vibrated, and the players would go like this. Technology was not that great in the 50s, okay? And it never worked right. Could never get that, never get the guy with the ball to go straight. He always ended up going the wrong way or something. But anyway, I says, that's the way I see people in the world. Oh, they're going somewhere, but they don't know where. And they're just vibrating through life, keeping busy. And God's basically saying, I've got a plan, and they don't see it. And I says, God, that just grieves me. And so I opened the Bible. I did have a thought. I hope the pages don't go blank again. I opened the Bible to Hosea 3:5 in the Living Bible. And as God would have it, the scripture came off the page and up in the air. I'm not exaggerating. Like right here. Living scripture to answer my question, why doesn't everybody know this? Why doesn't everybody understand this is the way we were meant to live? Hosea 3:5 in the Living Bible says, afterwards, they shall return to the Lord their God and the Messiah their King, and they will come trembling and submissive to him in the end times. They will come trembling and submissive to his goodness in the end times. Trembling and submissive, but coming to his goodness. Repentance, yes, but repentance and sensitivity to his goodness in the end time. Afterwards, after what? After, just like you, Dennis, after you tried everything else and it didn't work. After you exhaust all your silly efforts of getting on spaceships and finding out that just like the end of the world didn't come in 1988, and just like the spaceship never showed up in the Arizona desert, afterward, you will return to the Lord your God and to, some translations say, David your king, or Messiah your king, and you will come trembling and submissive to him and to his goodness in the end times. And it was then that God basically says, you're an end times preacher, and know this, that there are going to be many that have been casualties and wounded, and I'm going to be able to get them healed up and put armor on again. And once they've been restored, nothing to prove, nothing to lose. A humble army is a viable army. And God was even giving me you wouldn't even understand the illustration, I don't think, but he gave me the illustration of the Lone Ranger and Tonto. How many can remember that? The Lone Ranger used to have a mask. He had to hide his true identity. Tonto would go into town and get the snot beat out of him, all right? And God says the real man, the real hero, was not the Lone Ranger. The real hero was Tonto. He was the one that had to mix with people. He was the one that had to take the persecution and the beating. Tonto sat back in camp probably polishing his silver bullets or something. I don't know what he did in camp. But he had to hide behind a mask. Right? Okay. No, the Lone Ranger sat back in camp, while Tonto had to go into town and face the prejudice of all the people who are anti-Indian, right? So, I'm basically looking at this, and I opened it again, and that came off the page. And basically, this is 2 days in a row, and I'm going, on the one hand, it's comforting, but on the other hand, something's going on with me. And you know the reasoning mind gets in there fast, right? Come on, you've got one. That reasoning mind gets in there, and I'm going, troubling thoughts, but yet the joy wouldn't leave, but the troubling thoughts were there too. And it was like, I want to stay this way. I've never been so comforted that God was real and that he was for me, but then I don't understand why. This should be popes and bishops. And then I started questioning that man in the bookstore. Well, he's a Christian author, but he didn't have a collar on. I'm looking for his authority, you know. Well, how do I know? Maybe, why should I go to that Christian businessman's lunch because he said so? Yeah, I don't know. And he was an authority, and I started getting so troubled in my spirit with the questionings that I got in the car, and I says, I'm going to go talk to a church person. I don't know what church. I skipped the Catholic church, but I was going to go to some church. And I'm driving down the road, and I must have passed a half a dozen on State Street, a half a dozen churches, and I got in front of what I found out later was a Presbyterian church. I got in front, and as God is my witness, the car turned itself. The wheel jerked out of my hand, and I turned, and I'm going, oh, no, it's still happening. It started again. I've had 2 days of this. I can't do it the third day. I've got to know what's right. And I'm trying to keep from crying, but it was pretty hard to do because this is like all crazy stuff, and nobody ever talks like this. Nobody ever says stuff like this. I never heard stuff like this. And I have nothing to compare it to. So that car turned in, and I'm going, I got to do what I did in the bookstore. I don't know why I'm here. I go inside, and the minute I walked in the door, there was pamphlets on a wall, how to be born again. I went, ugh. So I did what I did in the bookstore. I walked over, and I'm browsing. That's the only thing I know. I got religious already. When you go into these places and God sends you, you just browse. So I'm browsing. And a woman, who is the secretary, said, young man, do you have questions? Grab me by the arm. They're always grabbing me by the elbow. And I'm going, oh, no, it's happening again. The car turns in here by itself. And she says, I've got the perfect person for you to talk to. And she takes me downstairs, and two men with collars were down there. And as soon as I saw that, I got authority. I'm going to blurt it out. And I blurted out like a machine gun and sobbing. I couldn't even see because I was crying so hard. And I basically said, I went to my mom's house, mom and dad's house. I said, I opened the Bible. This is that they think there's something. And he says, go to Grand Book and Bible. I went to Grand Book and Bible, and there was this man. And he says, go to this Christian businessman's luncheon. And I'm sitting in the joy. My body was going, and I'm going, I got, and he says, young man, do you know who I am? You're just a little bald-headed guy. I don't know who he was. He says, I'm the pastor from that church 25 miles away. And you know what else? He said, I have a habit. In those days, 80 to 100 people went up for those altar calls. I was one of 80. And 80 people went to the altar call, and this was Pastor Leonard Evans. And he said he had a habit, a spiritual habit, of sitting at a baby grand piano during the altar call playing, but God always had him pick out one person out of the entire altar ministry to pray for. And he says, this time, it was you that I was singled out to pray for. And then God spoke to me and says, you're going to see this young man again. Amen. He gave me a scripture that you hear almost every service. He said, I want to tell you something. Philippians 1:6 is the word that I'm giving you. He who began a good work in you will continue it. And actually, this is like the beginning. This is the first year, and my life has been like that all the way to, you can read our books about Jennifer and I and everything in between, the good, the bad, the ugly. But the word of your testimony is knowing that you've lived a purposeful life and that God orders your steps. And you who began a good work, he's going to continue it, even if you can't figure it out. And as a matter of fact, I never could figure it out until looking back in hindsight. And God basically says, that was the beginning. That was the beginning. And it's never really entered, because God basically said, you know what? You got to walk it out. It's not just supernatural events. You now need to live in that spiritual realm. So here I am, a young Christian, where the drugs had got me. Was I had a mobile home, was on welfare, and because I was on welfare, the mobile home had a lien put on it, because you can't receive something and own something at the same time, at least in that day. I don't know how it is now. And I would go to prayer, and God says, offer to pay back welfare. And it cost me $25, which was big money for a poor person. I mean, where we lived, it was like when Jason was little, after the trailer. Well, I'm getting ahead of my story. I'll tell you that part later. But anyway, in this trailer, it was basically had a lien on it, but God kept telling me to offer to pay back welfare. And it cost me $25 to call a lawyer to say, how do I pay back welfare? And he says, you don't do that. And I go, you don't do that? Well, I feel like I'm supposed to. And he was getting frustrated with me. And so he called. He says, why? Why do you want to do it? I don't want to say God told me, because then he'd really have a problem with me and he'd hang up. So I said, because I feel like I'm supposed to buy a house, and I can either buy or sell as long as I have a lien on my mobile home. Make sense? He said, well, let me call. He called and checked with the welfare system. There was no lien on my house, on my mobile home. The paperwork was there and never filed. I had other Christians look into it later. They said the paperwork was right there. They chose not to file it, but God knew that, and he basically says, if there's no lien, there's no lien. I sold a trailer, and God basically said, and this is the first of five miracle houses, and they're all a separate story in and of themselves, four miracle houses. But God gave me a scripture and says, now you can buy. Jeremiah 32, baby Christian, baby Christian. Buy my field which is at Anatoth, for it is your right to redeem it for 17 shekels of silver. Well, I don't know about 17 shekels of silver, but there was a house, kind of a ghetto area, for 17,000. So my first house was 17 shekels of silver. I got a Christian real estate person, and they said, we're going to get it. And God says, buy my field, which is Anatoth. Anatoth was a community of priests. And found out later that when I bought that house for $17,000, that it was a former parsonage. And you could feel the anointing in it. And I'd name it, go off on another story in there, but I'm not. But eventually, way in the future, when I started pastoring my church, Anatoth became a community of priests. Just like it said, almost all of my congregation moved within walking distance of that. We had a congregation of about 250 people, and I'd say a huge portion of my leadership all moved within walking distance. I remember Jason saying, coming home from school as a little boy, going, Dad, there's blood on the front door across the street. And I go, yeah, there was a murder there the other day. But I mean, this Dad, there's blood on the front door across the street, and they didn't wash it off. And I go, yeah. So, but it was a house of promise. And basically, there was a supernatural story that I'm not going to get into. I never prayed for a house, ever. God says, you take care of my business, and I'll take care of your business. You take care of my house, and I'll take care of your housing you. And it went from there to another house, to another house, to this last house. And by the way, in those days, that anointing attracted people. I never advertised. I never asked for a speaking engagement, ever. Still don't. And people just showed up to get ministry. They just felt led to get ministry. And I got ordained by an organization based on proven ministry, no Bible school, just based on the fact whatever he's doing, it's working. The eventual church was on that city I made fun of, had 12 acres, and the leaders dropped the price for what God gave me in prayer and cried, dropping the price because a church was going to go on there. And in their day, it was a campground where David Wilkerson used to come, and all of their children got saved and filled with the Holy Spirit. So it was sentimental to them, and they didn't want to sell it for the higher price to a commercial agency. They wanted a church to be on that, and they just wept and gave me a land contract, a very low interest land contract deal, and it was paid off in no time. It was not only paid off in no time, but a gas company came and said, can I drill? And they hit gas, then they hit oil, and the gas and the oil royalties went to the church, free heat and royalties on top of the free heat. And then they accidentally hit oil, the gas company. And so we got oil royalties as well. And you can see pictures of it in the bookstore. We built a dome sanctuary because we preached basically the atmosphere is what's important in a church. And the other thing, so all of a sudden, then it was paid off in no time. It had an outdoor kitchen. It had a garage that was big as some churches, where we housed our tractor, because even though God blessed me with this 12 acres, typical Dennis went, instead of rejoicing in all the good that God had did, I went, who's gonna cut this grass? 12 acres, that's all I was, who's gonna cut this grass? And then we established a parking lot and got a tractor and had an outdoor kitchen, had an indoor kitchen. It was an Italian Pentecostal campground, and their kitchen equipment was pizza ovens, top-notch restaurant equipment that when my insurance man came in and said, how much did you pay for this, pastor? And I told him, and he says, you need to repent. Your kitchen equipment, to insure your kitchen equipment, stand-up freezers, many of them, stoves, pizza oven, all stainless, he said, you stole this place. You should repent. This is an unsaved guy telling me I should repent that I stole that place. He said, all 12 acres, a two-story building that was only 13 years old. The downstairs fed 400 people. And we used that kitchen to feed the neighbors because we were spooky spiritual. So we figured that God gave us a dual mission. One, feed the community, and then be spooky spiritual too. all of that. And then, and then in 1990s, late 90s, I went through a divorce, had my spiritual father come, and I resigned the ministry. And there's only 1 year I was not in ministry, and that was the year. 1 year, actually, to the date. And of all things, God says, go to Charlotte. And I didn't never been south. I was kind of afraid of the south, to be honest, because I watched Beverly Hillbillies. I pictured Smokey Bear troopers seeing my Pennsylvania license and pulling me off and throwing me in jail, and the cousin was the judge, and I would never get out. I mean, that's terrible, the kind of pictures you paint. But if you're a Chicago boy and you never left Chicago, and then you move to Pennsylvania, it's about the same. You have no idea what to do. And I'm going, why? I've never even been there. And he told me to go to Charlotte and was giving me constant confirmation. My spiritual father says, relocation? He said, that makes sense. He says, obey God. And all I know is I had one verse of scripture where I says, I kept looking at a map south of Charlotte. And so I said, God, I got to have corroboration because I feel like this. I'm under too much pressure. I'm going through a hard time now. I need restored. I need to get things together. I can't be just running off, go to Charlotte, leave everything. And I looked, and I kept seeing south of Charlotte. And I look at Charlotte, and then I go south of Charlotte. And so finally, I just looked at the Bible. I went to the Bible, and God said, and Jesus went to Nain, which was just south of Nazareth or Capernaum. So I'm going, all right. Got in a car and came down. And as I was driving, I was crossed the North Carolina line. I saw like the Ponderosa map burn in the flame. And God basically just said, it was a Charlotte map, yeah, but it was all of North Carolina, South Carolina. It was a whole region burst in the flame, but it was going to Charlotte primarily. And he gave me one more verse of scripture. Now, mind you, I don't have any details. I have no plan. I have no job. I just resigned. I had a little bit of money from a canceled IRA. I mean, a cashed-in IRA. And that was it. And God told me that I would never see secular employment. So you put that in your pipe and smoke it. Think about that. How do you obey God when it seems impossible to obey God? But I knew from the time I was a baby Christian, he says, you're going to trust me for your vocation for your entire life. And good times or bad times. I even tried one time to go get a shoe salesman's job when I got nervous and scared. And I went, and they told me I was overqualified because I had managed a shoe store. They wouldn't hire me as a salesman. So then I tried to get a manager's job, and then the manager told me, no, you've already been trained in some other style. You wouldn't be a benefit to us. And then I got real guilty, and I said, you weren't supposed to try anyway. That was your lack of faith. So anyway, I come down, and I'm driving, and I saw that map explode, and God basically gave me one scripture. Do you realize I'm starting over at age 50, something like that? And I have one verse of scripture and no plan, and it was Jeremiah 29:7. The city in which you've been taken captive, pray for its peace, for in it will be your peace. So I said, I have one mandate from God, intercede. So I'm driving in, and I'm directionally impaired. I got to exit 1 and figured if I don't get off here, I'm going into South Carolina. I got off exit 1 and got lost, typical, right? And I got lost, and I pulled up on, I found out later, of course, that's Polk Street. I know where it's at now. On Polk Street, and there was some children's playground equipment on the outside. And I saw some cars in there, and I pulled in, and a man rolled down his window and said, you're going to ask for directions, aren't you? Because God had me sit in this car and not go in the building. And so I asked him, where is Randall Worley's church? Where is Mahesh Chavda's church? Where is Morningstar? That's the only thing I knew about the area. I was going to find church first. So he gave me the directions. And I was undecided as to where I was going to go. So I said, this is Friday. I'm going to go have a last meal. And I have my last meal at a big time at a restaurant right there in Pineville. What was it? Olive Garden, I think it was. And I went to the Olive Garden, and a waitress came over and sat down next to me. You don't do that as a waitress. That got my attention. She said, by some chance, are you from out of this area? Are you considering relocating? Oh my goodness. And I went, yeah. And she says, I just feel led to tell you this, that me and my friends, we work in Charlotte where the minimum wage is higher, but we live over the line in South Carolina where we can rent a little cheaper. Got up and walked away. I had a different waitress that waited on me. So I just tucked that away. I didn't know what to do with that. So then it's Saturday, and I'm going, I'm directionally impaired. If I'm going to go, I'll go to Morningstar first. That's where that guy gave me directions. I went to Morningstar. I'm still going to determine where I'm going to go. I only know 3 churches in this area, and God only told me one thing, intercede for this city. So I went to Morningstar, and I walk in, and they're having, on a Saturday, they're having an ushers meeting, and Bob Jones comes walking out from around, I don't know what he was doing there on Saturday, and he came out and he goes, you need to be here tomorrow. And then walked away. I go, all right, well, I'm not going to bother checking out the other 2. I kind of know where I'm supposed to be today or tomorrow. So I go the next day, and I'm there. And all I know is that I got to have a place to live. I lived in a hotel that night. You can't afford that, to live in a hotel with no job, right? Can't afford to eat at the Olive Garden every day either. But So I looked on the back board, and this is when they were on, what street is that? Presley. And on the back board, bulletin board, they had cards, call people. I called everybody on those cards for a place to stay. And I was either male and they wanted a female, or they wanted a student and I was too old for that. And so I met John Holcomb there, and I just told him, I said, you know what? I pastored, and I know it's hard to get the unspiritual stuff done. I said, just, I'll let you know, I'll do whatever you need to do. And he said, okay. And I said, do they have intercession here? And I said, yeah, they're meeting down at this brick building. So I said, that was my only scripture, right? The city intercedes. So I just looked for intercessors. And I called this one person, and they said, no, I'm sorry. And when they said, no, I'm sorry, the power of God flooded the phone booth. And I was like intoxicated with the presence, and I'm going, oh, this person feels what I'm feeling. And then on the other end, I heard, oh, my, oh, my, oh, my, oh, my, where are you? Where are you? I said, I'm in a phone booth across on South Boulevard in a phone booth. They don't even have phone booths anymore. I'm in a phone booth, and across the street, there's a Wendy's meet me in a half an hour. I'm calling all these phone numbers, and nobody wants me. And then all of a sudden, I'm in a phone booth, and she says, there's this man, I don't know who he is, and he needs a place, and God told me to give him this place, and I want prayer. I'm meeting him at Wendy's in about 30 minutes. So she meets me at Wendy's. She knows almost nothing about me, and she goes, I have a furnished condo on the lake at Tiga K, and you can have it for free. I had a furnished apartment for free because God told her to do something for this man. He who began a good work will continue that good work, even in spite of all your failures. This needs to be a word of encouragement to people that have given up and have quit. And God's not over with you yet. True repentance will get you back on track, just like that sliding door. And he gave me a railroad track that I might know him, that I might progressively become more intimately acquainted with all the wonders of his personhood. That'll get you back on track. That gets Dennis back on track. Everybody knows you slide a sliding door. You don't just take it off, and you don't try to open it like a regular door. And I had a furnished apartment. I mean, that thing would have rented for a lot of money. My next door neighbor was a doctor. And we were on the lake. And I would sit on the balcony and cry at the goodness of God for me. It didn't make sense because I feel like I lost everything I had ever worked for. And yet God is that good to me. Yeah, I guess it's not over. And so I'm going to intercessory meeting and I'm praying. Living free for the time being, it's working. At least I've got a furnished condo. Utilities are paid. And I'm interceding, and all of a sudden, God says, I want you to go to Jacksonville and intercede there. I'm going, I don't even know these people. I mean, I was at Morningstar for a number of weeks. I didn't know one person. Although Jennifer says, I was sitting at a table that had six women. She said, the sharks were circling. I was clueless. I wasn't looking for sharks. I didn't know I was in the water. But when I met her and brought her back, that's what she told me. I don't know. But I guess it takes a woman to see that. Yeah, they didn't speak to me after they met her. She said, that's a sign. I don't know. Guys are clueless, you know. They don't know what's going on most of the time. Anyway, so I'm basically interceding, and God says, go to Jacksonville and intercede. And I'm sitting in a worship service, and I'm not worshiping because I'm telling God that that's not good stewardship, because he gave me a free place. And if I go to Jacksonville, it's $65 a night in the DoubleTree Inn at my expense. And I'm telling God that's not good stewardship. I don't want to waste what little money I've got left. I don't want to do that. And then finally, after telling God it was not good stewardship, he got back at me and he said, if I put somebody in your room, will you pay? I was looking to put someone in my room and cut the cost. I was negotiating. And God was negotiating a little harder and say, if I put someone in. And I went like this. In my gut, I let it go and I said, of course. Yes. But I'm not saying none of this out loud. Yes. And the minute I said yes, a hand reached on my shoulder. It was John Holcomb. And he says, you know, with your background, he says, a group's going to Jacksonville, the intercessors. There's going to be intercessors from Brownsville, Jacksonville, and Morningstar. And he says, and with your background, there's a guy that wants to go down, but he'd be more comfortable with you than with a student. He's on Benny Hinn's staff. And my first thought was, he's working. he's on Benny Hinn's staff, but he doesn't feel he can afford it. Can he ride with you? I already had my answer. God already had me. If I put someone in your room, will you pay? And I said, yeah. So we rode down together, and it was very good. But the part that I didn't want to do was John Holcomb says, you said you'd do anything. We got to fold 3,500 flyers for that conference. I go, okay. He said, but we're going to give you pizza. And we got about eight people. And I think Victor and Ann know who I'm talking about because I forgot their names already. But there was... He says, and what we're going to do while we're eating pizza is we're going to tell our testimony. And I went, oh, great. I just resigned the ministry. I went through a divorce. And I don't have a life. I just dropped everything. And so I was a little bit on the cynical side. Like, I don't really want to talk about this. This is not what I want to do. And I'm going, oh, brother. And the first couple that shared their testimony, again, I laughed to myself. They said, and I usually mess it up, but it was a guy and a girl. She was from Hawaii. He was from California. And the Lord told the guy, you will meet your wife on this cruise. And you will know her because she will pray for you and ask you to pray for her. And I went, cool. When I thought of how many people I prayed for in my lifetime in ministry, like, that certainly wouldn't be a criteria. And I went, and I, to myself. And the minute I went, as God is my witness, my knees buckled, the power of God hit me, and I almost could stand, and God said, the same thing's going to happen to you. Ha, ha, ha. You know, kind of like, he didn't do that, but I did. I'll go, never laugh, okay? It's like, you don't know. And my knees buckled, and then I'm arguing with God, and I'm going, no, you don't understand. I'm never getting married again. You don't understand. Fifth gear, full speed ahead. It's ministry, and it's me and Jesus, and that's the way it's going to be, and I just ain't, and it's not going to happen. And then finally, it wasn't lifting, though. There was his presence was so strong. And I went, okay. But my bottom criteria is she would have to be my best friend. Amen. I've pastored long enough and seen tragedies. And if two people get married for any other reason other than a quality friendship first, the finances, the sexual areas, the in-laws, all that stuff will tear them apart eventually. In many cases, they need to be best friends. And as soon as I said that, it lifted. Enough. So I figured, 5-10 years down the road, I ain't worried about. The next day, I'm in Jacksonville, 90 intercessors, and I'm going, I don't need another conference. I'm just trying to obey God. So they said, of the 90 intercessors, we would like 15 to stay in the back room and miss the conference. Well, that was like pulling teeth, but not for me. It was like, I don't need another conference. I don't need to hear Joe Heavy speakers. I need to do what God told me to do, and that's intercede. So I volunteered to go in that back room. I'm in the back room, and there's 15. And I'm not telling Jennifer's side, but you can read it in the books. she was paid money to go to Israel, and God at the last minute said, even though she lost the money, don't go to Israel. And the lady who was her friend and intercessor, but the lady actually cleaned Jennifer's house. Get a picture. Jennifer had a huge house in Georgia, fireplaces in every room. This lady cleaned her house, and she said, God told me to pay your way. That got her attention. When the person that cleans your house says, I'm going to pay your way, should have been the other way around. And you're to go to Jacksonville as an intercessor. And don't take your daughter. There must have been something. There must have been a reason for that. And don't take your daughter. Because she hid behind her daughter to keep men away. And if that didn't work, she says, I'm called at a mission field. What about you? And then they, the guys usually, you know. All right. Remember that, ladies. She was running, too. She had an abusive husband. He was a medical doctor, but he was abusive. He was kind in the community, but abusive to her. And she said, I don't ever want another husband. And she had 17 prophetic words from it, from well-known prophets after he died, that God's sending you a man of God. And my sermon illustration in my church used to be, I love my two boys, but I always wished I had a little girl. And her daughter's prophecy was, he's not just going to be your mother's husband, but he's going to be a father to you, and he's going to teach you to drive, and he's going to say in his heart that I always wanted a little girl. That came later, though. So anyway, I'm in this back room, 15, minding my own business, doing what the only thing God told me to do, intercede. I'm interceding, and all of a sudden, with my back turned, her friend says, we're going in the back room. We're not going into the main sanctuary. So they drag Jennifer back there, and Jennifer is praying. And when I heard her voice with my back to her, my knees buckled. I'm going, oh, my God, all my life, at least 20 years, I had a half a dozen pastors that I met with once a week, and I go crazy now. When I'm all alone and isolated. Doesn't that sound like the devil? He's getting me. I'm going goofy now. And there's nobody to bounce nothing off of because I'm on my own now. And I don't have that support system here. And I'm going, and now I'm hearing this. And there's your wife. And you're going to get married. And I said, I'm still screwed up. I need healed. I don't need to get married. That's not a solution. And I'm going, oh, Jesus. Oh, God. And then I hear her talking. And that voice, my knees buckled. And I go, that's her. And I'm going, oh, no, am I going to play this one cold? That's her? And I turned and looked at her. And remember that story of that couple? And Jennifer goes, I want to pray for you. Oh, no, it was going to happen the same way. Oh, my God, no, this can't be a coincidence. This is too much. And so I'm going to really put God to the test. I was actually kind of almost rude. Okay, I'll let you pray. You pray. But in the inside, I'm going, oh, my God, oh, my God. All right, thank you. And I started to walk away because I didn't know if I could maintain my composure. And I started to walk away. She said, wait a minute, I'm not done yet. Get back here. And so I'm going. And so I'm saying, oh, and then what happened? What was the next part? We walked out.
Well, the next day, we went to lunch.
The next day, first of all, there was 90 intercessors, and one day we came out of a meeting, and two participants pulled a reserve seat, and out of 90, there was two people who didn't have a seat. It's that woman. Me and that woman are the only two that don't have a seat. So we sat back a few 6-7 rows, and we went back, and we've seen some of the videos from the morning star. You can see Dennis and Jennifer sitting together in the back somewhere like this. And I'm looking down and still really upset about this. This is your wife, and I don't have nobody around here to talk to. This is not normal. This is not the way I counsel people. And I looked down, and she's got a bunch of rings on her finger. I didn't pay attention what finger, but she got her. I went, oh, Dennis, lighten up. She's married. And I went, like that. And so I said, Yankee, you is plural. You say y'all, okay? But up there, you means plural. So I says, your girlfriend and this group, you want to go to lunch after this? And she goes, oh, I haven't been out with a man since my husband died. Oh, there went my little confidence bubble right up. So we went with a group, and we went out to eat, and we're sitting down, and I'm getting relaxed with this woman. And Jennifer says, when we get back to the building, I want you to pray for me. I turned white. I went, because remember, it was supposed to be, it didn't happen in that room both ways. So I was getting confident. No, God doesn't make mistakes. He said the same way. And she didn't ask to pray, have me pray for her. It was only one way. She prayed for me. She didn't ask me to pray for her. But she did it, and I turned white as a sheet. I put my head down in the middle of the restaurant, and I'm going, I am not going to tell her. Oh, you're my wife. That's why. And so she kept going, come on, come on. What's the reaction for? Come on, come on. And I'm going, oh, yeah, yeah. And I'm going, oh, God, help. And he brought that word, friend. And so I gave her the whole story and said that God was going to give me a friend. And she said, I'll be your friend. Oh, God, oh, God. So the next day at the conference, I can't concentrate on intercession. I can't listen to speakers. I was walking the halls. I'm walking the hall, and I have like 3,500 people, maybe more. The fire marshal was concerned there was too many. I opened the door just to peek in, but like kind of like you go to a refrigerator, but you're not really hungry. I just opened the door, peek in, and the usher turned. He says, you're looking for your wife, aren't you? The one with the blue-printed dress, and he described Jennifer. And I close the door, and I'm still walking the halls going, oh, God, oh, God. Well, it gets worse. There were some intercessors from my former pastorate at the conference who were in the balcony, and they said, I think we saw the pastor down in the front row. And they went looking for me, and they went looking, and I was in that back room, and Jennifer was down the hall praying for some woman, and she walked up to me. She says, you know, we taught the prophetic, you don't do babies or marriages. Okay, she goes, I know you taught us differently, but I was walking down the hall and I had an open vision. You wouldn't believe this. Come here. And she called me out into the hall and pointed to Jennifer, says, I saw you married to that woman. Just goes to show you God can do it any way he wants to, whether you were taught that way or not, right? Not that it didn't have enough confirmation already. So I was just totally wasted. And then basically, I went back to Charlotte. Jennifer went. And Jennifer went to Waycross, Georgia. And I called her. And she started reading some of the prophetic signs. I had to level because I can't, emotionally, I can't handle this. And I'm just going to level and tell her what I said, and then she'll drop it. And she didn't drop it. And she started reading to me her prophetic words that after her husband died, how many prophetic words she had about a man of God that was coming. 17 prophetic words, very specific by well-known international prophets who called her out. Even almost, some of them you got almost within a week after her husband died. And it was like, and she had turned down a billionaire who was an elder in a church. And she says, that ain't a man of God just because he's an elder in the church. But her friends were trying to fix her up. So she turned down billions for me. Wow.
And a golden cage is still a cage. A golden cage.
And that's what the Lord told her. A golden cage is still a cage.
Right.
And so she basically, I called her and then I leveled with her and she started reading the prophetic words. And from that time on, we had, in 1 year, I had Jennifer worked as a school psychologist in Monroe. She was also could have gone to Fort Mill. Yeah, we got married real soon after that, matter of weeks. And she came up here and got a job at Monroe. And for that 1 year, God told me, I will restore you in 1 year if you obey me. And when we got married, I says, it was a creepy feeling. I've worked all my life. And to this day, 7 days a week is normative in ministry because you love what you do. You don't consider it sometimes. You don't even consider it work. And Jennifer worked that first year. And it was a creepy feeling. She's working and I'm not. And God said, for a season, you'll be like the widow of Zarephath, and you will house the prophet for a season. So she felt, for 1 year, I'm working. And God says, for the next 6 months, interesting, because it should have been longer. But he said, for the next 6 months, your ministry is that little girl who lost her dad. And I drove her to school in Rock Hill, to a Christian school. I sat and ate lunch with her. I got to know her girlfriends. I told her which ones were real Christians, which ones are faking. And she thought that was really cool that I could discern. And in that six-month period, though, she just really came around. And she would tell me stuff that to this day she tells me stuff she wouldn't tell her mother, and probably better off not. But yeah, that was in her wild season. But anyway, it was so fun to drop her off at school, and she would go on the chapel day. She'd wear the skirt and the nylons, and she was such a lady. I'd pick her up after, and her nylons were ripped to shreds. Some boy made a wise remark, and I tackled him and beat him up. So I saw the transition. But anyway, I'm sitting in Morningstar, and a man named John something, forgot his name already, said, I don't know who you are, but I've been sitting on this word for a while. For the next 6 months, that got my attention, because God told me this little girl, 6 months, for the next 6 months, you're to prepare materials for teaching and preaching. I don't even know if you're interested in that kind of stuff, but I have to say it. So he said it, the next 6 months, but it was right approaching the 6 month mark with Allison, and we started writing materials. 1 year to the date that I resigned, a church off of Tivola asked me to come and speak. I didn't even know they knew me. Asked me to come and speak to the exact Sunday that I had resigned 1 year prior to that. 6 months of preparation, 6 months of working with Allison, and then 1 year. That was God's criteria. And then that launched our traveling ministry. Pastor friends that I had known from years back all started asking me, it's time for you to get going, Dennis. It's time for you to get back in the saddle. And we started traveling for about 12 years. This is just the beginning. And the purpose of this testimony is not to talk just about me, but that God's got a plan like that for everybody's life, whether it's dramatic or not. And if you've gotten off course, today is the day to get back on. All right? How many are ready to get back in the saddle and say, God, whatever you want? Because the God story is the only place to live, not your good ideas. My good ideas always crashed and burned. But God's ideas are as alive today, and there's a season of convergence right now, where things are coming together, and he's bringing those old things and making them valuable. I really believe there's people even in this room right now, as well as on Ustream, that this is God's given you another chance. Not that it's the only chance, but that God is a God who wants you to get back. And I believe that he didn't send you here by accident, but it's on purpose, and that it's time for you to get back on track and fulfill what God has planned for you. And you will understand it better in hindsight, naturally, but for the meantime, obey. I don't care if everything goes blank, but obey. Obey the last thing that he told you to do, and don't doubt yourself, because God has given you the equipment to hear from him. And very often, even like what I saw, is it took a lot of dramatic stuff. I don't know why. Maybe because I was prone to talk myself out of stuff. I don't know. But I'll tell you what, God doesn't want your sacrifice. He wants your obedience. So, Father, we pray right now that there's people going to get back on track. There's people that even this day, by the hearing of the ears, they're going to take the word of my testimony, and through the blood of Jesus, the cleansing power, repent of getting off track. But God is saying the word of your testimony is about to emerge, and you're about to get back on track. For this is the day of salvation. Now is the acceptable time. This is a day of convergence, and that God has made all things possible. This is a time where there's a trumpet calling forth to get you back on track. So receive forgiveness for judging yourself, for disqualifying yourself. Forgive people who have disqualified you, and say that it isn't over till it's over. And he who began a good work is going to continue it. That was the word that Leonard Evans gave me in that little Presbyterian church. And I'm telling you, I'm still saying it today, that if I began a good work, I'm going to continue it. So let's worry about continuation. Let's consider ourselves to be continually obedient to the things that God tells us to do, regardless of what it seems like to the natural. In Jesus' name. Amen.
You've been listening to Pastor Dennis Clark and Dr. Jennifer Clark of Full Stature Ministries at forgive123.com. Full Stature Ministries reserve all copyright protections under applicable law. Our copyright policy is available at our website, forgive123.com. For more information about Full Stature Ministries and additional life-transforming materials, please visit forgive123.com.